Yes, hello everybody. I greet you all in the name of Jesus. You're welcome to our broadcast today. Today you've seen the topic, you know already what we're talking about. It is power as of old. Power as of old. As you come, I ask you to please help us to share this video. Share. As you're coming in, I want you to please share with your friends, share with your family members. Let's bring them on. We welcome you. We welcome you. Welcome, welcome. Thank you. We know you have been waiting. Let me just adjust this camera. All right.
Hello, 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 Bro Charles.
Hey, how are you, sir?
I'm doing good. And you?
All right.
Okay.
As you are coming in, we want you to share, invite people. Let's get everyone invited. As you know, it's our custom that our videos are usually short. Why do we do short videos? Why? Because we have elaborate teachings on YouTube, Truth Sets Free. Some of them we do post on Facebook as well, but primarily the channel that we maintain all our Bible study teaching is on YouTube. It is called Truth Sets Free. We run two sessions. On Saturday, we'll run for everywhere in the world, except North America. So we have people from all over Europe, Asia, Africa, and majorly on Sunday, 8 p.m., we run for U.S. and Canada. So if you're watching from any of these places, feel free to join our YouTube and Bible study teaching. You have to request to have access, and we can add you to the group. So today, let's get straight to the crux of the matter. When you hear power as of old, when you see the banner for this program, you can see an old Nokia cell phone. Imagine you are trying to do Instagram or Facebook live broadcast using that phone. It is impossible because that phone has limited technology compared to what is available now. So when we are talking about power as of old, you are thinking about something from the past and bringing it into the future, or thinking that there is something from the past that we have missed so much and we have to look at it in this present day. So this is what we have come to put out to you today, and we trust God that is going to be something revolutionary.
Okay, so, you know, one of the critical things that has confused us is how we combine the Old Testament with the New Testament. Many of our confusion today came from the inability to properly divide. You know what Paul told Timothy? He said, study to show yourself approved, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. See, most of the confusion we are having today is as a result of our inability to divide the word of truth. So today we just want to do a little bit of dividing. Like Brother Charles, as earlier said, this is just a short one. If you want in-depth, detailed teaching, check it out on our YouTube channel, Truth Set Free. Truth Set Free. Probably we'll post it on the YouTube comment link, and then we can move on from there. So go ahead, Brother Charles.
So today we are going to start. We have beautiful people helping us to type in our Bible scriptures. Please, Sister Shola and the rest, Sister Mary, as many as possible, help us to fill in the Bible scriptures as we go. We welcome you all. Because the video is short, we don't have too much time. Let us start by heading straight to a popular verse of the Bible that you have heard, I believe most of us, from conventional churches that originated from Africa, and most especially Nigeria, where messages are being preached about Elijah and Elijah. Do we even hear messages about, with the topic power as of hope, mm-hmm. that there is something they had that we didn't have to do, but we want to see how true is that. So we're going to start today. Go ahead.
Well, before we read this scripture, let us just teach you the scriptural approach, or the biblical approach to handling the scripture. Paul said in Romans 1:16, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. The gospel of Christ is in all parts of the scripture, from Genesis to Revelation. So when we read the Old Testament, for us not to be in error, For us to be in compliance, we must read the Old Testament with Jesus' eyes. Let's put it this way, Brother Charles. The New Testament is Old Testament explained. Or yep. The New Testament is God's explanation or God's interpretation of the Old Testament. That's why the only yes. person, the best person that has the best explanation for the Old Testament is Jesus himself. He said in John 5:46, he said, if you have believed Moses, you will have believed me, for Moses wrote about me. Everything we see in the Old Testament is all about Jesus. So we want to open one of it today, the most popularly used one, to mean fire from heaven. So go ahead, brother.
Oh, yeah.
2 Kings
all right.
2 and verse 14.
Let's go. So he struck the water with Elijah's cloak and cried out, where is the Lord, the God of Elijah? Then the river divided, and Elijah went across. So in bringing this passage into quick context of the way it has been used, is that Elijah was a powerful man of God. He had a protege called Elisha. When it was time for Elijah to go, he went, Elisha saw him, he picked up the mantle, that is what we call mantle today, mm-hmm. the cloak, the Bible mm-hmm. referred to, and what he did next with the mantle is he departed the river with it. And you know, before that time, he asked the prophet Elijah, mm-hmm. can I have
double portion
of your anointing? At that time, anointing was important. That's note that. And so he, but he couldn't get, he got the cloak, and the Bible recorded factually that Elisha did twice the miracles of Elijah. But you see, when you read it like that, that is what we call CRA, religious Christian. CRA,
that's a Nicodemus.
Christian religious knowledge.
That's a Nicodemus.
Because that is elementary. But now, when we take it from the eye of Christ and come back into this same scripture, mm-hmm. finding alignment to what happened to Jesus himself, we are able to see clearly where the error started from and what should be the right.
Okay, so let's go into it. If you read verse 14 and you are running, you will get into confusion. I will suggest that you start from verse 1, but don't worry, this is a short video. I will start from verse 9. When they come to the other side, Elijah said to Elisha, tell me what I can do for you before I am taken away. Everybody knew that Elijah was about to go. Elisha knew, and other prophets knew. In fact, at the beginning, in verse 1, verse 2, and verse 6, they were expecting. In fact, they told Elisha, your master will be taken away today. He said, keep quiet. Okay? So when he knew, so Elijah asked him, what do you want from me? And Elisha replied, please, let me inherit a double share of your spirit and become your successor. Then verse 10, you have asked a difficult thing, Elijah replied. If you see me when I am taken away, when taken from you, then you will get your request. But if not, then you won't. What an answer. See, then in verse 11, as they were walking along and talking, suddenly a chariot of fire appeared, drawn by horses of fire. It drove between the two men, separating them, and Elijah was carried by a wild wind into heaven. Elisha saw it and cried out, my father. Okay, this is it. This is the key. This is the key here, and that's why I want your mind to be here. The key here is Elisha asked Elijah, I want a double portion of your anointing. Elijah said, you have asked a difficult thing. How be it if you see me? What does it mean to see Elijah when he's going? Because what is coming to pick Elijah is a spiritual force, a spiritual wind. Elijah is going to be converted to a spirit being and is going to depart. So what does it mean to see me? See, the answer to that question is in verse 12. Elijah saw it and cried. No, in verse 11, as they walked along and talking, what were they saying? See, Brother Charles, silence, everything in the Bible has meaning, including silence.
Oh, yes.
Let me give an example of silence. I have a dog. My dog barks whenever it sees a stranger at night. On this day, someone entered into my house and my dog did not bark. That silence is a message.
That means the dog is familiar with the process.
That means that dog saw somebody that he knows. Okay, that silence is a message. There's a silence here. Bible did not record what they were saying, but they were talking. Discipleship. Elisha was listening to Elijah. They were conversing. Bible did not say, did not record what they were saying. But you have a clue in verse 2 and in verse 6. If you read ahead, Elijah kept telling Elisha, return. Elisha said, no, I will not. Elijah said in verse 6, return. Elisha said, I will not. He was listening to him. He was teaching him. He was asking questions. He was growing. See, there can never be Christianity without discipleship.
Absolutely.
There will never be Christianity without discipleship. Go ahead.
Absolutely. There is something you will do outside of discipleship. Because this man, many prophets in the time knew that Elijah will be taken away.
They knew.
But they don't know what it takes to be a partaker, to be a witness, to know exactly and precisely what it is that would happen to this
man. All right.
So it's like for you, knowing that the world is coming to an end, or there's going to be world war, but you don't know the country where it's going to start.
Exactly. In verse 12, Elisha saw it and cried out. Why did he see it? Was it the only prophet? No. Because in verse, if you look at it downward, between verse 15 and 16, there were other prophets. How come they didn't see it? But Elisha was able to see it because he has grown. There can never be Christianity without discipleship. He was speaking to Elijah. What were they saying? He was asking questions. He was hearing his word. He was growing. And when the chariot came, he was able to spot it. He wasn't the only one around. But he has grown to the point that he could identify the spirit, which means he had grown maturity. Hmm. Now, that takes us, having done that, understand that foundation in verse 13. Then Elisha picked up Elijah's cloak. You see, this is another thing we want to talk about. Elijah was taken away by wild wind, and his cloak fell down. You know why? Because it cannot go to that realm. So anything we labor for, apart from the will of God, we're just wasting our time. Everything we made on this earth will not go to that realm. So Elijah was translated, but his cloak fell. See, and Elisha picked up that cloak and he went to the riverbank. See, this guy was passionate at this time. He struck.
He has just. Hold on. He has just lost his master.
Yeah.
He was a disciple under him, and suddenly his master went.
So he was bitter.
Number one,
he was bitter.
Number one, his emotions is that this is the only thing I have left that belongs to my master.
Yep.
Words is intangible. You can't do anything with it.
So, and there's nothing special about that cloak. In verse 14, he struck the water with Elijah's cloak and cried out. He struck it and cried out, "Where is the Lord, God of Elijah?" Then the river divided. It wasn't the river that divided the water. It wasn't the cloak that divided the water. God did. Why did he cry? Because he had grown. He had switched spiritually. He had followed Elijah and he had switched. So what spattered the water? God did. The same way when he resurrected, Bible said he rose up, folded the cloth and left it. People did not go carry that cloth and turn it to a mantle.
When they went into the tomb, it was women that went and they saw the clothes.
Folded.
And they said, all we saw was the
clothes. And they didn't turn, Jesus, they didn't turn his clothes to mantle. Now the Bible, the Old Testament should make more sense to us because we have the Holy Ghost. These people do not have the Holy Ghost at that time. So when we are reading it, we should have a better understanding. If Elisha had not touched that water with that cloth, if he prayed to God, it would still have parted.
Absolutely.
Yeah, because following his master, focusing on discipleship, he had grown spiritually. Now, the next thing why I will prove to that he had grown is that in verse 15, when the group of prophets, you see, not just him, when the group of prophets from Jericho saw from a distance what had happened, they were at a distance. They didn't grow. They didn't come close. Okay? Then they exclaimed, Elijah's spirit rests upon Elisha. You see, you and I will know that these prophets were wrong. They don't understand what is going on here. That is why the Bible must be rightly divided. We can't just take Bible line hook and sinker. We and I understand that this other prophet's assertion was not correct. They said in verse 15, they exclaimed, Elijah's spirit rests upon Elisha, and they went to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. Assumption. They began to worship an assumption. Nobody sent them. Assumption. Okay. Then, sir, they said, just say the word, and 50 of our strongest men will search the wilderness of your master. Perhaps the spirit of the Lord has left him some of the mountain. So, how come they don't know where he's going? Because they didn't grow.
So hold on. The Bible told us that the spirit chariot of fire took him up to heaven.
Elijah knew where he's going.
These guys now said, let us go and find him in the mountain.
Because they didn't grow.
So they were, if they are not sure where he went, we shouldn't believe what they saw.
You see, because they didn't listen to Elijah. They were far away. Elisha listened to his master. He was discipled. He was listening to the words. He had grown. This one did not grow. So they knew he has gone, but they thought it's on the mountain. But Elisha is not moved by the assertion because he has left that realm. His spirituality has grown to that point. You see, when we read this scripture and we just look at a strong man that took a strong cloth, then Jesus' clothes should have been turned to mantle. So whoever turned this to a basis for mantle, the power of God as of old, is a Nicodemus, a CRS teacher or a BK teacher.
Okay, guys, our time is fast approaching. Let us now put the final armor on this scripture.
All right.
So let us now go.
Go ahead. So this now explains to us the difference between the prophetic realm. There's Old Testament prophet and there's the New Testament prophet. So having understood, having read what is happening here with the eye of Christ, then we now realize that whoever is operating in the Elisha capacity today is stepping out of syllabus.
So what is now our proof, according to the epistles, that the person has stepped out of the syllabus?
Okay, so now let us look at 1 Corinthians 14, 1, 2, 3 or so. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 14, 2 and 3.
This will be our second to the last scripture. We have a final one. Okay. 1 Corinthians 14, 2, 3. Okay, verse 2 and 3.
1 Corinthians 14.
For if you have the ability to speak in tongues, okay, you will be talking only to God.
Okay.
Since people won't be able to understand you, you will be speaking by the power of the Spirit, but it will all be mysterious. Verse 3. But one who prophesies strengthens others,
encourages, and comforts. Strengthens, encourages, and comforts. A prophet is not the one that calls your bank account, your street address, your telephone number. A prophet edifies, comforts, and the last one, strengthens, encourages. So now that takes us to the ultimate that opens it up for us. Hebrews 1:1. God.
Guys, I want you to listen to this, please. Long ago,
okay,
God spoke many times and in many ways to our ancestors through the prophets. And now, in these final days,
He has spoken to us
through his son. God promised everything to his son as an inheritance.
So,
and that is why you will remember the first message that Peter preached after the fire came, after the Holy Ghost came.
Acts 2:17.
And he said that
I will pour out
these last days, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh.
All mankind.
All flesh. Not few men. Not two portions. Not three portions. All flesh.
See, by chance, this is going to be a bomb. Elisha said, we have to connect this back to Elisha. Elisha said, can I have a double portion? Read what Jesus said in John 3:24. Elisha in 2 9. I want to have a double portion. But see what the Bible says about Jesus.
John 3:24. Sorry, where is it here? Spirit without measure.
All right, you got it?
I'm finding it here. It's not 24 for sure.
Oh, 34. John 3:34.
Okay. For he is John sent 3, by God. John talking about Jesus. He said, for he is sent by God. For he speak God's word. God gives him the spirit without limit.
Without limit.
Another translation says, without
KJV limit. Said, for God has speaketh the words of God, for God giveth not the spirit by measure unto him. This one says he wants double portion. This one says God gives spirit without measure. Which one do you want?
Guys, now it is the realm of unlimited. Don't subject yourself praying for double portion. They are leading you back. It's like bringing a Volkswagen engine to fly a private jet. The engine does not have the capacity to undo anything that we experience. Now that we
so what happened in 2 Kings is not a prayer point. It's an understanding of relationship. It's an understanding of focus. Elisha was focused with on Elijah, and he was learning, and he was being discipled. Today, our focus is not on Elijah or on Elisha. Hebrews 12:2, looking unto Jesus,
the
author and finisher of our faith. So, Hebrews 2 Kings is not a prayer point. It's an understanding of focus. Now that we have understood what focus can do, if focus could give Elisha double portion, if you focus on Jesus, you will not only have double portion, you have unlimited
portion. Unlimited portion.
Unlimited portion.
And on this note, guys, we ask that the Lord will bless you and remain blessed.
Amen.
Goodbye for now.
Bye.